الحمد لله رب العالمين، اللهم صل وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، all praise is due to Allah and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, to his companions and all those who follow them on the righteous path until the day of recompense. Brothers and sisters in Islam, in our last lecture, youth in a booth. For those of you who missed it, you didn't miss it all the way, you can find it online on YouTube. But I do suggest that if you haven't watched that lecture, to watch it and then watch this one. Or you can watch this one then watch the other one, but they're related. So don't watch one without the other. Or you may. Anywho, we discussed many problems that the youth face, the most common problems. And it was one problem which I deliberately did not elaborate on. I kind of just mentioned it briefly because I had decided to dedicate a whole lecture for that particular problem due to its sensitivity and its significance. In fact, very often it is that fine line between remaining steadfast upon this deen or being led astray and going to al-jaheem. That one element, that one problem is very often a fine line between remaining steadfast upon this deen or going astray and ending up in jaheem wal-iyadu billah. And so it deserves that we deal with it based on its gravity. Being the social creatures that we are, human beings need to interact with one another. They need to mingle with one another. They need to mix with each other. Without that, you can't really survive. Some people have tried it and they turned out to be abnormal. The normal human being, it's part of his life to deal with people, to mix with people. And when mixing with people, this is going to influence us either positively or negatively. And there's no third choice. Mixing with people will have an effect on that individual. Islam, being a complete way of life, recognized this fact and provided the Muslims with directives and solutions. If we were to act upon them, then we will be able to deal with and mix with the people in a manner where we do not damage and harm ourselves, and it would be positive. If we don't, however, then we will suffer the consequences which may extend to the life to come. The consequences will affect us in this life and will follow us until we make it to the life to come. We will pay for the consequences of ignoring the Islamic directives concerning how to deal with people, how to socialize, how to mix. Even though there are many narrations which qualify to take center stage when we address this particular topic, I chose one, the one which we got the title of the lecture from, The Seller of Musk. And again, these titles, there's an element of entertainment in them, particularly when people misinterpret them. So someone thought we were going to sell a mosque for Salah. Said the seller of a mosque. Said, no, it's the seller of musk. And some people were not aware of what musk is. And then is it seller? Some people thought seller was sailor. The sailor of a mosque. You're going to go in a masjid, have a boat, and sail in it. And you wonder what happens, you know, when the title is clear, but there's always some sort of misinterpretation. The seller of musk is an expression which we learn from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, the hadith of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiyallahu anhu wa ardah, he said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مثل الجليس الصالح والجليس السوء كحامل المسك ونافح الكير ونافخ الكير فحامل المسك إما أن يحذيك وإما أن تبتاع منه وإما أن تجد منه رائحة طيبة. ونافخ الكير إما أن يحرق ثيابك وإما أن تجد منه رائحة خبيثة. It's an amazing hadith. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam struck the similitude of the good companion and the evil or bad companion is like the seller of musk and the blacksmith or the ironsmith or the blower of the bellows. You know that old tool which they used to, you know, ignite the fire? It's like, you know, this is the bellow. They go like this for the fire to remain lit. And it's basically air. That is the blower of the bellows. Blacksmith, ironsmith, whatever, haddad. In common, today, modern day terminology, is called haddad. So either the companion, the bad companion is like that one. As for the seller of musk, you have a few choices. Either he will give you some. The Prophet ﷺ said, either he will give you some for the sake of Allah, free. This is the one which we all prefer. Or he will sell you some. أو تبتاع منه. You will buy some from him. Or at least you would leave having smelled something pleasant. Whereas the blacksmith, either he would burn your clothes or you would leave having smelled something bad, disgusting, repugnant. So we learn, there are many lessons, by the way, which the scholars are amazing people because they look like us, but they're not like us. We read a narration and they read a narration. And we read the narration, we go over it like, okay, that sounds nice. However, they read a narration and they will deduce and pull out hundreds of benefits from this narration which would never even cross our minds. Some may not. But this is the virtue of the ulama, the people of knowledge. Some of the things which the scholars have deduced from this particular hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. First is categorizing friends and companions into either beneficial or harmful. Your buddies, your close friends, either will benefit you or they will harm you. Just like the seller of musk and the ironsmith. That's the first benefit. The actual categorization of friends. How many of us do so? How many of us actually have categorized their friends? They know that Fulan is someone whom I should keep company with, contact, because there's benefit. And Fulan are people who I should avoid. Unless I'm giving them da'wah. Most people don't go through that. Everything goes. And they mix with everyone. But that's not what the Prophet ﷺ was aiming at. The second benefit is explaining the benefit and the harm. Why are people going to affect you in this manner? How are they going to benefit you and or how are they going to harm you? Let's look at it. In the light of the hadith. If you're hanging out with a good person, he is equivalent to the seller of musk. Now, alaykum salam. Now when you hang out with a person who sells perfume, what is the mood? What do you usually find on your face? A smile. Specifically if the smell is pleasant. Now, they're speaking of misk. In English, it's musk, which is one of the most pleasant scents that we know of. In fact, Jannah, you know, it's in Jannah. It's so good that even the drink, khitamuhu, misk. I mean, misk is not your average scent. So the Prophet ﷺ has given us that you know, nowadays they consider the oud and what have you, you know. But misk is unparalleled in the world of perfumes. Naturally, you will smile. You will feel good. This is only if you were in the company. When you're in the company of the righteous people, if that person's heart is sound, then you will have a similar feeling. This is before anything happens. How about if you if they gave you some for free? If that person who caused you to smile simply because the smell, the scent is good, when he gives you some for free, what happens to your smile? It increases or decreases? Some people can't stop it. Stop smiling. Stop smiling. Can't stop smiling. Why? Happy. Halal fun. Alhamdulillah. Not the kind of fun people have elsewhere. So he gave, why? He gave you some for free. Your funus is still in your pocket. And you got something. If that doesn't happen, and you paid for it, still you are getting something pleasant. You feel happy that you paid this money because you didn't get a pack of cigarettes. You got some misk. You get something good. When you hang out with the righteous person, you're about or you're bound to benefit from him one way or another. If he's your teacher and you're enrolled in a class and you're paying money, still you're learning the deen. If he gives you nasiha and advice all the time, alhamdulillah. And if none of that happens, just in the company of this person, getting the pleasant smell, then this is sufficient. The bad companion, on the other hand, will do exactly the opposite. The first thing, notice now the hadith says, إِمَّا أَنْ يَحْرِقَ ثِيَابَكَ. He would burn your clothes. And how would you feel when someone burns your clothes? Have you seen anyone celebrate after their clothes getting burnt? It's a very displeasing idea. Even the idea is displeasing. Let alone the actual event taking place. Why? People love their clothes. Even if they don't look good, they like them. Right? So burning, he's going to burn your clothes. When he burns your clothes, what else happens? You're naked. Or partially naked. Depending on how much he burns. And if none of that, if the damage doesn't get that bad, at least, or even that bad, you got a bad smell. So your reputation will be tarnished simply by hanging out with the wrong people. If your niyyah is not da'wah, we have to exempt the people of da'wah who may mingle with particular people for da'wah purposes for the sake of Allah. We're speaking about people who you're comfortable with, that you like hanging out with. Once you hang out with the wrong crowd, then you will fall from the eyes of people. Your reputation has been tarnished. This is if they don't destroy you with them and they burn you up. And you ask 90% of smokers, whether they were smoking weed or smoking cigarettes or smoking something else, what led them there? Their buddies, their circle. They were all right. But when you hang out with these people, I mean, if you hang out with smokers, the first day you're strong, the next day you're strong, after a week you're strong, then afterwards, you're going to find a cigarette and hanging in your mouth. And you were against smoking, perhaps you warned against it. Why? That in that company affects you. So this is the second benefit. The third benefit, the Prophet ﷺ is in fact encouraging us to keep good company. When you hang out with someone who likes to pray in the masjid, who likes to pray in the first row, we ask Allah to make us among those. What happens to you? You're forced to pray in the first row because your buddy prays in the first row. And when you hang out with someone who usually joins the third jama'ah, you know what I'm saying? Because he's always late and you can't leave him. Sometimes you're in his car. I mean, you are in a situation where you can't depart. If you can depart, leave him. Even if your close friend and your buddy and whatever, if he's going to delay you from salah, salamu alaykum. Open the door and walk out. Whoever it is, whatever it is. But sometimes you're in a situation where you can't do that. Guess what? Perhaps you are the kind of person who never misses salah in the first row. You hang out with one lousy brother and he will ruin your five daily prayers for one day. You go out, you know, visit him in some other city and he will ruin your salah. Why? Because he has that effect. So Prophet ﷺ is encouraging us to hang out with good righteous people because they will rub off on you. You see him pray, doing a sunnah that you have been abandoning, then he will start acting upon the sunnah. You see him enjoying the good and forbid the evil. You used to be shy. Next time around, you do like him. You enjoy the good, forbid the evil. Say, why? Why can he do it and I can't? I mean, it's endless and countless the benefits which you get from hanging out with righteous people and vice versa. You hang out with the wrong person, you see him, he's brave in disobeying Allah, and then you may pick up on this bravery in disobeying Allah. You see him disrespectful to the elderly, you'll become disrespectful to the elderly. This is human nature. The Prophet ﷺ used striking examples as means of teaching. And this is something known in the Quran and the Sunnah. وَاضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَاءٍ إِلَىٰ آخِرِ Ayat are many ayat. Allah Azza wa Jal will strike the similitude or the example of such and such. Why? Because this brings the idea closer to mind. And this is one of the most effective ways of giving da'wah to the non-Muslims. You explain an Islamic concept, they fail to understand, say no problem. And give them a worldly example which they can relate to. 99% of the time, the Islamic concept will be understood in the light of the method, the example. Try it. And there are hundreds of them. So this is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And anyone involved in teaching, if you're a teacher, language teacher, otherwise, one of the best and most effective ways in teaching people is by striking similitudes and examples. And using opposites. The Prophet ﷺ used opposites. The seller of musk and the ironsmith. One will, you know, one is bad smell, everything is dirty, everything is filthy, and the whole mood is stinky. And the other one is, you know, you can imagine white clothes and, you know, nice and fluffy and beautiful smelling stuff. It's like opposites. And that affects, your brain will visualize these two concepts. And you, if our يعني, fitra, if our natural disposition is sound, we will lean towards the good things, the beautiful things, and we will strive in attaining them. Now, we have another hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith of Abu Hurairah in Tirmidhi, which was authenticated by Shaykh al-Albani rahmatullahi alayhi. He said alayhi salatu wasalam, Ar-rajulu ala deeni khalilihi falyanzur ahadukum man yukhalil. Ajib. A man is upon, and a woman is included, but you know, kharaja makhraj al-ghalib. Most of the time, the Quran and the Sunnah will address men, and both are included unless there's another evidence which necessitates that this is strictly for men or strictly for women. But most likely, men will be used because this was the audience. However, women are understood and included. So the sisters don't think that you're not included in this. A man is upon the religion of his close friend. A man is upon the religion of his close friend. What that means is, you will have the same interests, the same, you'll have many commonalities, otherwise friendship would have never existed. The reason why you have a friend is because you agree on many different things, which made you hang out with each other, because when you hang out with each other, you have the same kind of direction. So you do the same things. If every time two friends wanted to do different things, they will no longer be friends. So you know what, you go your own way, I'm going to go my own way. So friendship necessitates agreement. So what it means here, the deen, meaning the what kind of deen is he upon? Even if he's a Muslim. If he's a Muslim, you'll be upon his methodology. His understanding. His way. I'm speaking about your close friend. So the Prophet ﷺ warned us by saying, فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يُخَالِ. Let each one of you looks, observes, evaluate. Who are you befriending? Who are your friends? Who are the people you hang out with? Are they the losers or are they the successful people? Whichever one you find yourself hanging out with, you can automatically categorize yourself with that group of friends. If your friends are righteous people, then inshallah you're upon the religion of your companion. And if your best friend is a loser, then guess what? I don't have to say it. Again, exception to the rule, du'at or anyone who is doing da'wah and his intention in hanging out with this person is to bring him back to the deen. I'm not speaking about the one you're just comfortable with and there's no da'wah going on. And be careful of the shaitan tricking you. Say, yeah, I'm hanging out with them to give them da'wah, and they're really giving you da'wah. You know, because it happens. So I'm giving them da'wah, hey, what happened to you? He's gone. They gave him da'wah. Next thing you know, he's, you know, calling you to what they were calling him to. And so this happens to people. We have to be very careful, and we have to seek Allah's, you know, refuge, and we have to seek Allah's guidance continuously to make sure that we are upon the right path and we don't go astray. Allow me to enumerate some of the benefits which one attains from hanging out with the righteous people. Then we will speak about some of the harms which one attains by hanging out with the bad people. First, the righteous person will aid you in doing good deeds. What is the evidence for that? Who can think of an evidence? Think of an evidence from the Quran that a righteous person will help you do good deeds and be patient and all that good stuff. Wake up. Beautiful, but that's not what I'm looking for. A surah which everyone has memorized. Wal asr. Inna al-insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat wa tawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bis sabr. We all know the surah. Allah swore by the passage of time that every human being is immersed in loss, fi khusr, except those who believe and do righteous deeds, and then they enjoin and help and remind one another concerning the truth and concerning patience. So when you hang out with these people, you're actually excluding yourself from the losers. Because Allah made a condition for us to be successful that four things must be done. The iman, the righteous deeds, and then the enjoining of the truth and patience. If you don't have a friend that helps you do that, you cannot manifest and fulfill this ayah or the surah. Because the surah necessitates watawasaw in the plural. So you must have someone helping you out. And this is a fact. Like I gave you the examples earlier, a righteous person will bring you to righteousness and you will pick up on some good deeds which you have never performed before. And you only started performing because you hang out with such and such person even for a few hours. Allah further said, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَيُطِيعُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ أُولَٰئِكَ سَيَرْحَمُهُمُ اللَّهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. Amazing ayah. And the believing men and the believing women are helpers and allies to one another. Why? They enjoy what is good, forbid what is evil, they establish the salah, pay the zakah, and then the last one, and they obey Allah and His Messenger. Then listen to the ayah. Listen to the end of the ayah. Ulaika, those, sayarhamuhum Allah. Allah will definitely show mercy to them. Verily Allah is full of might, most merciful. So Allah Azza wa Jal promised rahmah for the believing men and women who enjoy the good, forbid the evil, establish salah, pay zakah, and obey Allah and His Messenger. The believing men and women. Again, it's a matter of companionship. The people around you will help you enjoy the good and forbid the evil, help you establish salah, remind you of zakah time, and they will remind you to obey Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Secondly, you attain the blessings of their gatherings. Even if one of us was not as good as they were. Listen to this hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu ardah. The hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. Inna lillahi malaikatun. عفوا ملائكة يطوفون في الطرق يلتمسون أهل الذكر. Allah Azza wa Jal has angels which wander around the earth seeking and searching for the people of remembrance of Allah. فإذا وجدوا قوما يذكرون الله تنادوا هلما إلى حاجتكم. Once they find a group of people remembering Allah, they will say to one another, come to what you're looking for. And we ask Allah to make this gathering one of them. And we believe, inshallah. You don't have to see the malaika to believe. We're not speaking about music or anything else. We're speaking about the deen of Allah. So this is the majlis of dhikr, inshallah. And the angels will be wandering around. When they find this, they will call the malaika, the other malaika. Come, halum, come. Ila hajatikum, come to that which you have been looking for. And the hadith continues. At the end of the hadith, Allah says, فَأُشْهِدُكُمْ أَنِّي قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَهُمْ. Allah will say to the malaika, I make you bear witness that I have forgiven all of them. Listen to this. We ask Allah to make us among those as well. I make you bear witness that I have forgiven all of them. يَقُولُ مَلَكٌ مِّنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ فِيهِمْ فُلَانٌ لَيْسَ مِنْهُمْ إِنَّمَا جَاءَ لِحَاجَةٍ One of the angels say, "Oh Allah, among them is a person who's not one of them. He came for some other purpose. For example, this gathering. One brother came for the lecture, and he told the brother, the other brother, after the lecture we're going to have dinner. So the other brother said, okay, I'll come to the lecture for what? For the dinner. Ah, he doesn't care for the lecture, yalla. But no problem, I'll listen. Al-muhim the qadmushi after the lecture. Hey, he comes along with him. The malaika, one of them will say, oh Allah, there's fulan with them. He's not really part of the group. He's not here for dhikr. He has another objective. Allah will say, humul julasa la yashqa bihim janisuhum. They are such people that even their companion is not left destitute and unfortunate. Yeah, because he's hanging out with them, even though he has other intentions, he will be forgiven too. Why? The blessings of the people of dhikr and the good companionship. Hanging out with the right crowd will get your sins forgiven. Hanging out with the wrong crowd and will get your good deeds erased. Subhanallah al-Azim. Understand the importance of companionship. Furthermore, the harmful, well, that's enough for now. What about the harmful consequences of hanging out with the bad and evil people? First, distance. They will distance you from the good deeds and they will beautify evil deeds for you. The first thing they will do is they will pull you away from righteousness. You were doing some good, say, akhi, you're extreme. That's the first thing. The first thing is, they will title you as a fundamentalist, extremist, you're diseased. You got problems. Why? You strictly follow the sunnah. And, akhi, today, you know, modern Islam, modernism, chill out. You know, you need to be diplomatic. You know, the whole world is changing. So you change the deen as well, yani, you know, being intelligent. Or call it being dumb. You're going to change the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to please France and the UK and America and I don't know what, I don't know who, and some bunch of kuffar here and there. Psh! If someone does that, that's the epitome of loss. I mean, if we were leaving something from the sunnah because of a statement of an imam, from the imams of Muslims, this is blameworthy. So you're going to ignore the sunnah because of an imam? What about when you ignore the sunnah because of a kafir? Who will never be pleased with you until you say, I'm a Jew, I'm a Christian, I'm a Hindu, I'm a Buddhist. Only then they will say, now Mia Mia, come and join us. Until then, every time you leave alone something for their sake, they will require you to leave something else. Then you leave something else, then they require something else until you have nothing left of Islam. وَلَن تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَا النَّصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. Neither the Jews nor the Christians will ever be pleased with you until you follow their religion. Their millah, not even their deen, their millah, their way of life. Then they will be happy with you. And you can understand the same thing against the rest of the kuffar. So what are we abandoning the sunnah for? For who? Who cares what they think and what they do? You stick to the sunnah. So the first thing they'll say, you're an extremist. Slow down. Huh? Slow down, take it easy, chill out. You know, they say take a chill pill. Is this still used nowadays? That was old, sorry. I'm still out of fashion. Tahir. But don't believe that. He will distance you from good deeds, then he will beautify evil deeds for you. I'm not going to give you many examples. You can understand what I'm saying. They will get something which is haram, and they will try to make it appear light. That this is not a light matter, everyone does it. That's the other thing. First, you're extreme. The second thing, akhi, everyone does it. You're going to tell me everyone is misguided? MashaAllah, you're the only one on the path. Huh? Everyone in the world is misguided. I mean, everyone is misguided according to, you know, what they say you. And you're the only one guided? Yeah, all these people are wrong and you are right? Tell them yes. How did you know that, MashaAllah? Your observations are getting better every day. Because Allah said in the Quran, وَإِن تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَن فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّكَ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. If you obey the majority of the people on earth, they will mislead you from the path of Allah. Specifically nowadays where Islam has become strange amongst the Muslims. Don't be shocked if you become a stranger and an extremist simply for doing 30% of the sunnah. And Allah knows if there's that 70 minimum 50% of the sunnah which we don't act upon. And we're speaking about the best one of us, perhaps 50% of the sunnah doesn't act upon, still the people say he's an extremist. Then what would they say about the sahaba who were trying to do 100% of the sunnah? Which one of us today gives, you know, all of his money for the sake of Allah? Ma'lish. Like Abu Bakr did. And like Umar used to, you know, strive. Which one of us goes out seeking their widows and the orphans and, you know, applying the sunnah concerning them or even their rights, let alone the sunnah? How many of us, we have abandoned most of these things. And still you have some wicked shayateen among the ins telling you you're too much, you're too extreme. Ma'lish, akhi, do this sin, everyone is doing it. And the biggest evidence for that is Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had 10 uncles. 6 of them died before Islam, before the advent of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 4 of them witnessed Islam. 2 of them accepted Islam. 2 of them remained kuffar. Who are those who accepted Islam? Hamza. Umar ibn al-Khattab, Allah musta'an. Now who's the most famous cricket player in the world? Alatul, they will give you the name. Al-Abbas, where do you get Ibn Abbas from? Al-Abbas, the one whom after the Prophet ﷺ died, the Sahaba would go and say, do istisqa for us. Not as the Sufis claim, that they will you know, do shafa, they will do through him. They used to tell him, ask Allah to give us rain, because at the time Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to ask him, he would do us the scar. Now you are his uncle. And Hamza, Asadullah, the lion of Allah, Sayyid al-Shuhada, the leader of all martyrs. Who are the ones who didn't embrace Islam? Abu Talib and Abu Lahab. Abu Talib and Abu Lahab. Abu Lahab, you know his story. Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin wa tab. May Allah curse him, his wife and his child. Because all of them harmed the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though they were relatives. They were supposed to treat him the nicest. And Abu Talib, who was not like Abu Lahab, he defended the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But now at the time of death, what happened? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to give him da'wah again. And who was there? Abu Jahl and Abdullah ibn Umayyah ibn al-Mughira. And he used to say, Ya Am, قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ كَلِمَةٌ أَشْهَدُ لَكَ بِهَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. Oh uncle, say La ilaha illallah, a statement which I would bear witness before Allah that you said it. And Abu Jahl and Abdullah would say, أَغَيْرَ مِلَّةِ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبِ. You're going to leave the religion of Abdul Muttalib, and he died upon kufr because of the evil companions who chased him all the way till the last moments of his life. Allah knows, had they not been there, and it was a private session with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would have embraced Islam. Allah decreed he doesn't. We're not objected to the qadr of Allah azza wa jal. But we learn a lesson that the bad companion chased them all the way till the last moment and reminded him of kufr before he died. So the bad companionship or the bad companion and friend will pull you away from good deeds, purify evil deeds for you, so he may destroy you in the process. You will hardly ever remember Allah when you hang out with the wrong people. In the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu wa the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا جَلَسَ قَوْمٌ مَجْلِسًا لَمْ يَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ فِيهِ وَلَمْ يُصَلُّوا عَلَىٰ نَبِيِّهِمْ إِلَّا كَانَ عَلَيْهِمْ تِرَى فَإِنْ شَاءَ عَذَّبَهُمْ وَإِنْ شَاءَ غَفَرَ لَهُمْ. Hadith fi al-Tirmidhi sahahu al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no group of people sit together while not remembering Allah or sending the salam upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, except that they are held accountable. This will be something against them on Yawm al-Qiyamah. If Allah wills, He will punish them, or if Allah wills, He will forgive them. When you hang out with the wrong crowd, with an evil person, is he going to say, you know, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or is he going to remember Allah? No. There'll be bad language, foul mouth, cursing, all the bad stuff. When you hang out with the right people, the righteous people, the name of Allah is being mentioned all the time. When they see something amazing, what do they say? Subhanallah! Did you see this, yaqi? They see something nice. MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. You hang out the wrong crowd? I'm not going to give you examples. Wow. You know what I'm... Wow is good! Let him say, wow, barakallah fiqh. No, no, they say something else. Something totally different. You may not hear it in this country, but those outside know what I'm talking about. I mean, your whole day is this stuff is going in your ears. A'udhu billah. So, you know, that makes a difference for you. Now, a very important evidence is the hadith of the one who killed 99 people. You know the hadith of Muslim. Where the Prophet ﷺ said, a man who preceded you killed 99 people. He asked about, the most righteous person or scholar. They led him to a abid, a devout worshiper, He didn't really have any knowledge. So the killer, the criminal, told him, is there any tawbah for me? I killed 99 people. He said, no tawbah for you, man. You killed 99 people, no way. So he killed him, made him 100, because he made him despair from Allah's mercy. But the man wasn't satisfied. There was still goodness in him. He again asked about the most knowledgeable person on earth, and he was led to a alim, a scholar. After having killed 100 person, he said, is there any tawbah for me? He said, who will prevent you from tawbah? But then he said, however, you are in a land, bi'ardi su', you are living in a land of evil. Move out. And you all know the hadith. He moved out, he died on the way, the angels of mercy took him. Because of his niyyah, he didn't pray, didn't fast. He only simply repented to Allah and was on his way to hang out with good people. That saved him. And because he was in the wrong crowd, he killed 100 people. This is a fact. And this will lead us to something later on, inshallah. You will see what. Now, am I on the right track? I should be. I'm missing a note card. Here we go. Now, the one who disobeys Allah Azza wa Jal, the evil companion, will be a source of regret on Yawm al-Qiyamah. وَيَوْمَ يَعَضُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَىٰ يَدَيْهِ يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي اتَّخَذْتُ مَعَ الرَّسُولِ سَبِيلًا يَا وَيْلَتَى لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أَتَّخِذْ فُلَانًا خليلا لقد أضلني عن الذكر بعد إذ جاءني وكان الشيطان للإنسان خذولا عجيب. يعني the ayah is explicit on the day when the wrongdoer will bite on his hand out of regret. And he will say, I wish I had taken with the messenger away. I wish I followed the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I was righteous. Woe to me had I not taken Fulan as a friend. He has misled me from the remembrance after it had come to me, and ever is the shaitan a deserter of the human being at the time of need. Subhanallah. One person misled him from the remembrance of Allah, and on Yawm al-Qiyamah he will bite on his hand out of regret that this one person destroyed my life. He couldn't take away with the sunnah because of an evil companion. So it would be a source of regret on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allah says, الْأَخِلَّاءُ يَوْمَئِذٍ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٌ عَدُوٌ إِلَّا بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌ إِلَّا الْمُتَّقِينَ. Close friends on that day will be enemies to one another except the muttaqeen, the righteous, God conscious. Your best friend will be your biggest enemy on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Pay attention. Your best friend will become your biggest enemy on Yawm al-Qiyamah unless you and him were categorized and labeled as muttaqeen in the book of Allah. In the book of deeds with Allah. If you're both not righteous, then you would become the biggest enemies to one another. And there are many more. Now, this leads us to a very important point. Two things which I would like to discuss, which are related to this topic, but not really to the core of it. First, the Muslims living abroad amongst the kuffar. If we were to understand what was mentioned earlier, and if we were to reflect on the ayat of the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and that a bad companionship will affect your deen, a big question mark comes, which is, then what about those Muslims who are dying to go abroad, to live amongst the non-Muslims, which is a disaster? Or even lesser than that, what about the Muslims who are living there already and have not done migration and hijrah for the sake of Allah? Let us look at some narrations which many people don't like to hear, because this has become a commonly spread disease. Fascination with the Western world amongst the Muslims is unbelievable. We're dying to go there, and they're dying to kick us out. I was reading on the news, on the internet, on CNN. concerning the burqa ban in France. See, we don't understand. We're sitting there, you know, demonstrating and whatever, protesting in the streets and blah, blah, blah. And the comments that the people leave are, when we go to your country, you force us to wear, the ladies, aren't they not supposed to wear a jilbab? Okay, when you come to our country, France, for example, then why don't you follow the traditions like we follow your traditions? Otherwise, get out. You're not welcome. And why would a Muslim allow a kafir to tell him, get out of my house? Our dignity is superior and more important than a kafir to tell me you're not welcome over here. When I have plenty of Muslim lands where I can live. Mind you, they're not the best Muslim places on earth. You will not find Islam being implemented all the way. I understand. Perhaps not even implemented. But when you're amongst the Muslims, no one is going to tell you, well, you're not welcome here. Because these are your brothers in faith, even though the government may not be applying. Alhamdulillah, this is not the case in Saudi Arabia, but not everyone can come here. But to be living among a kafir, and he tells you, look, if you don't like my law, get out. That's very bad. That's very bad. So wake up. Wake up. And we need to stop humiliating ourselves because Allah does not allow this. Al-izzah lillahi wa li rasulih wa lil mu'mineen. Dignity, might and honor is for Allah, His Messenger and the believers. And the more we love Allah and His Messenger and we sacrifice for their sake, the more Allah will honor us and vice versa. Now listen to the narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The hadith of Abu Dawood, he said, من جمع المشرك فهو مثله. Whosoever mingles with the polytheist, he is just like him. If you mingle with them, mix with them, live with them, eat with them, see him in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening, you will become like him. And this is what happens. Slowly but surely, they start abandoning some elements of Islam until Islam is gone altogether. And you will not know he's a Muslim unless he pulls out a passport that says Muhammad. Otherwise, you look at him, his name is Mo, and he looks like a rooster, and he just totally, totally abandoned Islam. Seriously, you will never know that this is a Muslim. Why? Well, akhi, you know, come on, brother, you know, the beard, you know, ma'alesh, yani they don't think the beard. Well, Harley Davidson, you know, riders are rocking beards all day, and we didn't see anyone tell them to shave their beards. Why are you afraid of your beard? Well, yeah, I know, but you know, the thawb, akhi, ma'alesh, you know, I got... Brother, quit that stuff, man. If you mix with them, according to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are like them. Man jama'a, and according to the tafsir of the ulama, it's not the jima'a which you get between a husband and wife. Jama'a meaning you mix with them, you mingle with them, you accompany them and live with them, you will become like them. It doesn't happen to everyone, but it happens to many people. In fact, most people. And you probably came across some of them yourself. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أَنَا بَرِيءٌ مِنْ كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ يَعِيشُ بَيْنَ أَظْهُرِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ بَيْنَ ظَهْرَانِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I am innocent. I am innocent of every Muslim who lives among the disbelievers. He's innocent of them. Doesn't want them. Doesn't want him to be with him, alayhi salatu wasalam. Why? Because they're living and mixing with the kuffar. So those who are out there, try to get out. I know there's a difference of opinion among the ulama. Don't think I'm not aware of that. Alhamdulillah, I know some say it's mustahab, some say it's wajib. Nevertheless, the truth is, I've seen them. He's seen them. Many brothers have seen them. The father is in the masjid in the first row for every salah. The son, if you tell him Islam, he will call the police on his father and say, he is harassing me. My personal freedom of religion and belief, this man is harassing me, and the father will be taken to jail. He can't even tell his son, come with me to the masjid. And now in France, if a father forces his daughter who's underage to wear the veil, he will be fined $30,000 and he will be put in jail for 1 year. As a father, you can't tell your daughter, your wife to wear the hijab anymore. And it begins with France, and it will go somewhere else. They were the most courageous in declaring war against Allah, His Messenger, and the Muslims. Don't think the rest are not dying to follow their footsteps. But there they are now, the trial version. They will try it out. If the Muslims don't, take over the whole world, they will continue. And we're not in a position to take over the whole world. Because in Salatul Fajr, there's barely a row. Barely a row in Salatul Fajr. At the time of Iqamah, the rest, if they leave their bed and come, they come after 15-20 minutes from the end of Salah, just before Shuruq. This is besides the ones that pray after Shuruq, and the list goes on. We're not ready. We're not ready. Too much love for the dunya, we're not ready to take over the world. So what is going to happen? We're going to live there and have this happen to us? Listen to the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He said, Al-Muslimu wal-Mushriku la tatara'a narahuma. The Muslim and the disbeliever should not see each other's fires. What does that mean? Back then, the Arabs, living in a tent, whenever he wanted to barbecue something, whenever a fire was lit, generally, it would be done in front of the tent. This was where they would put it. The Prophet ﷺ is saying that the distance between you and the Kaaba should be as such that if he were to light fire in front of his tent and you light one in front of your tent, you should not be able to see each other's fire. How far is that? If you were to look right now at something burning over there, how far is your sight going to go? That's pretty far. If you scream, he can't hear you. He said the Muslim and the Kafir should not see each other's fire. This is indicating that the distance should be as such, let alone living in the same dorm with them, because college requires that my degree in the university should be blah, blah, blah. So he sits next to Fulan and Fulana and this and that, and next thing you know, he's on vacation. He's on vacation from the deen. إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ اللَّهِ. I know. Say, brother, no, my cousin, mashallah, he went there and Allah guided him, he became a big da'i. Jazakallah khair. That's an exception to the rule. And I will name 10 in turn who went there, they were okay, came back, nothing. So don't use an exception as a rule. Because there's always an exception to the rule, and the exception is never the rule. We know some people make it, and some people don't. Don't play with your deen. Muslims, if you're able to leave, barakallah feekum, leave. Leave. And depend on Allah. The issue we have is reliance upon Allah. Wallahi al-azim, wallahi al-azim, wallahi al-azim. That we know brothers and sisters who left their countries for the sake of Allah, wallahi Allah blessed them in ways and provided them from places they do not expect. You would never believe. They were barely making ends meet, and their Western country, whatever that is, the Kafir country, I don't want to say Western, Kafir country, they were barely surviving, barely living, and they did hijrah for the sake of Allah, and they found blessings which they cannot even begin to enumerate. And Allah promised us in Surah An-Nisa, وَمَنْ يُهَاجِ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ يَجِدْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُرَغَمًا وَسَعَةً. If you were to travel upon the earth and migrate for the sake of Allah, you will find plenty and vastness of risk from Allah Azza wa Jal. On the other hand, الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ قَالُوا فِيمَا كُنْتُمْ قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُوا فِيهَا. The angels will come to take the souls of those who mixed with the kuffar. Those who ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ, they were wronging themselves. The angels say, فِيمَا كُنْتُمْ, what was your affair? They will say, we were weak on earth. We can't wear the hijab, we can't wear the niqab, we can't call the adhan from the masjid. So the angels will say, wasn't the land of Allah vast enough for you to travel upon it? And Allah said at the end of the ayah, فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Those their abode will be the hellfire, and what an evil abode it is. And this ayah, go back to the tafsir of the ulama, in Surah An-Nisa, is speaking about hijrah for the sake of Allah and the blessings therein. And the danger of remaining amongst the kuffar. And we need to be with each other. The separation is no good. The Prophet ﷺ worked on keeping the Muslims always as a community, the jama'ah. Why? Because we will benefit from one another. We will strengthen one another. We will help one another when we are separated. And divided, it's very difficult to have something happen. something positive which will benefit the ummah, very difficult. So coming together as Muslims is necessary. And one of the means to do so is doing hijrah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, another issue which I have time to discuss, not that much time, but this is very important. When we speak about good companionship and evil companionship, a question arises. What do I do with my sinner friends and innovators? I have friends, companions, you know, acquaintances that are sinners, and some that are bid'ah, people of bid'ah. They act upon some innovations. What do I do with them? Do I stick with them, leave them, and what is their treatment? There are some people whom we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to guide, who have a total misunderstanding of the deen, even though they think that they understand the deen the most, and Allah knows that they don't. And the problem with these people is, they are just like the Tablighi Jama'at, they're like Sufis, like any other group. They take one part of the deen, and they make it the only thing which they deal with. Everything else is kind of trivial, important, but not as important as this. And because of that, they again strive to divide the ummah. These people, according to them, I shouldn't be, or you shouldn't be mixing with me or talking to me, or because we are all in one way or another sinners or innovators. Why? Because you don't belong to their group. And once you don't belong to their group, you must be a deviant individual. If you don't accept their sheikh, then you really are not upon the manhaj. Subsequently, some of them may see you in the street and not give you the salam. And some of them may hate you for the sake of Allah more than they hate a Jew or a Christian. In fact, they will respect him and disrespect you. Why? Feeble-mindedness? Partially. Following desires? Definitely. Evil and corruption is part of their way. And the biggest problem is that they don't recognize it. But Allah told us about that category of people in the Quran. وَمَنْ يَعْشُ عَنْ ذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَنِ نُقَيِّدْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِينٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ لَيُضِلُّونَهُمْ عَنِ السَّبِيلِ وَيَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. Whosoever turns away from the remembrance of Allah, the Quran and the Sunnah, according to the understanding of our righteous predecessors, Allah said, if you turn away from that, Allah will assign for you a shaitan, he will become your close companion. And now listen to the next ayah, and verily, those shayateen will be misleading them from the path while they think that they are rightly guided. The biggest problem is they don't see it. Say, hey, hello, you're going astray, you're leading others astray. Allah knows they are blinded because their shayateen are leading them astray. But let's see what the ulama, al-ulama al-rabbaniyin, or here it will be marfu' al-ulama al-rabbaniyun, say concerning this idea of boycotting a Muslim because he's a sinner or he's a deviant. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullahu ta'ala, in this collection of fatawa, volume 28, page 204, he says, النوع الثاني الهجر على وجه التأديب. The second kind is boycotting someone as means of correcting them or disciplining them. وهو هجر من يظهر المنكرات يهجر حتى يتوب منها حتى يتوب منها. And it is the boycotting of someone who displays wrongdoing, he displays the sins, he does it outwardly, he is boycotted until he abandons them. Don't jump into conclusions. You have to read the rest of the Shaykh's statement. كما هجر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المسلمون الثلاثة الذين خلفوا. Like the Prophet ﷺ boycotted the three who did not go for jihad. You all know that. Ka'b ibn Malik and the rest of them. حتى أنزل الله توبتهم until Allah revealed that he accepted their tawbah and repentance. حين ظهر منهم ترك الجهاد المتعين عليه بغير عذر. When they left alone jihad, which was compulsory on them, without a valid excuse, they were abandoned. However, ولم يهجر من أظهر الخير وإن كان منافقا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did not boycott the one who displayed good outwardly, even though he was a hypocrite. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew he was a hypocrite. He did not boycott them. He kept relations with them. فهذا الهجر هو بمنزلة التعزير. This kind of boycotting is like this discretionary punishment. Discretionary punishment meaning تعزير is for example when there's a head. There isn't a penal code in Islam for like drinking alcohol or fornication, that the judge will exert his knowledge and give the person a punishment according to what he sees fit. So this is one of this kind. والتعزير يكون لمن ظهر منه ترك الواجبات وفعل المحرمات. This you do for the person who outwardly leaves alone obligations and he engages in evil deeds. كتارك الصلاة والزكاة والتظاهر بالمظالم والفواحش والداعي إلى البدع المخالفة للكتاب والسنة وأجماع سلف الأمة التي ظهر أنها بدع. Like the one who abandons Salah, he involves himself in wrongdoings, and the one who opposes the Quran and the Sunnah and outwardly proclaims bid'ah, which has been agreed upon as a bid'ah according to the Quran and the Sunnah and the righteous predecessors. The Shaykh said, وهذا حقيقة قول من قال من السلف والأئمة إن الدعاة إلى البدع لا تقبل شهادتهم ولا يصلى خلفهم ولا يؤخذ عنهم العلم ولا ينكحون فهذه عقوبة لهم حتى ينتهوا. This is how we interpret the statement of the righteous predecessors when they said, the one who invites to bid'ah, not the one who falls into bid'ah because he's ignorant, he doesn't know, the mubtadi' who's inviting people to bid'ah, like Tahir al-Qadri and their likes, just to give you an example, so you will know what I'm talking about. He said, it is those whom their testimony we reject, and it is those whom we don't pray behind, and it is those who we do not take knowledge from, and it is those whom we don't even marry, meaning we don't give our daughters in marriage to them, and vice versa. And this is a means of punishment for them until they desist. The Salaf used to make a distinction between the caller to bid'ah and the one who's not calling to it. The one who is calling, he deserves the punishment. I'm going to read in English right away. As opposed to the one who can, the concealer. He's doing wrong, but he conceals it. He's not calling the people to it. This is not more evil than the hypocrites. And the Prophet ﷺ used to accept what they did outwardly, and he would leave their secrets to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though he knew the reality of their affairs. So the Shaykh went on to say, the evil deeds must be outwardly also are unlike the inward ones. Yani the things which you do wrong before the people are not like the ones that you do behind closed doors. Then he said, and وَهَذَا الْهَجْرِ, this boycotting varies depending on those who are being boycotted or the boycotters in terms of قُوَّتِهِمْ وَضَعْفِهِمْ, in terms of their strength and their weakness, وَقِلَّتِهِمْ وَكَثْرَتِهِمْ, in terms of their number, if they are small in numbers or large in numbers. يعني it doesn't apply all across the board. You have to take into consideration when you're boycotting, who has the upper hand, who is stronger and who is weaker, and who is larger in number and who is weak, lesser in number. فَإِنَّ الْمَقْصُودَ بِهِ زَجْرِ الْمَهْجُورِ وَتَأْدِيبِهِ. What is intended is that you reprimand the one who's being boycotted and you correct him. وَرُجُوعُ الْعَامَّ عَمِثِ حَلِي, and that the layman, the common people, will avoid following his footsteps. فَإِنْ كَانَ الْمَصْلَحَ بِذَلِكَ رَاجِحًا. Don't lose your concentration. This is important. فَإِنْ كَانَ الْمَصْلَحَ بِذَلِكَ رَاجِحًا بِحَيْثُ يَفْضِي هَجْرَهُ إِلَى ضَعْفِ الشَّرِّ وَخِفْيَتِهِ كَانَ مَشْرُوعًا وَإِنْ كَانَ لَا الْمَهْجُورُ وَلَا غَيْرُ يَرْتَدِعُ بِذَلِكَ بَلْ يَزِيدُ الشَّرُّ وَالْهَاجِرُ ضَعِيفٌ بِحَيْثُ يَكُونُ مَفْسَدًا ذَلِكَ رَاجِعٌ عَلَى مَصَالِحِ لَمْ يُشْرَعِ الْهَجْرُ. The Shaykh said, so if then the benefit outweighs the harm, meaning if boycotting this person is going to lead to more evil and create, and the person whom you're boycotting, the boycotter, is weak, then boycotting is no longer legislated. Now let me ask you a question. How many people are upon the Sunnah today amongst the Muslims? Minority or majority? Minority. We ask Allah to make us among them. We are a minority. We are in the actual weaker position. There are more Sufis and more grave worshippers and more, you name, you call it what? We have so many groups now than those adhering to the Sunnah. We are actually in a lower position. And we would hear the statement of Sheikh Albani. So according to the ulama, at this point, it is not legislated to boycott these individuals. The Sheikh said, فَتَكُونُ خَالِصَةً لِلَّهِ. The hajr, the boycotting must be for the sake of Allah. فَمَنْ هَجَرَ لِهَوَى نَفْسِهِ. So whosoever boycotts someone because of his own desires, أَوْ هَجَرَ هَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَأْمُور بِهِ كَانَ خَارِجًا عَنْ هَذَا. Or he boycotts for some other reason, then he's not included in that. Now listen to this. وَمَا أَكْثَرُ مَا تَفْعَلُ النُّفُوسِ مَا تَهْوَاهُ ظَنَّةً أَنَّ تَفْعَلُهُ طَاعَةً لِلَّهِ. How often do people do what they desire, thinking that they're doing this to obey Allah? Oh, I will boycott this guy. Why? Well, because for the deen of Allah, for the sake of Allah. And Allah knows this is for the sake of desires. You don't like him, he's more famous than you, he has more lectures. Allah knows what evil intentions you have in your heart. But he will tell himself it's for the sake of Allah. And Shaykh al-Islam said, how often do people boycott others for the sake of their desires while thinking that they're doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So we learn from this that we do not boycott unless there's a benefit. It's like a medicine. If given the medicine is going to cause the disease to become worse, you don't give the medicine. If the medicine is effective, you give the medicine. Boycotting the Muslims is like that. Nowadays, if you boycott someone, what's going to happen? He's going to be happy. He's going to say, great, psh, you get out of my face, and I will get out of your face. And what's the bottom line? He will remain upon his bid'ah until he dies. Had you mixed with him, even without compromising your deen, but with intelligence, with wisdom, you slowly brought him to the sunnah, then this is what is expected in this day and time. Because we are in that particular position. Shaykh al-Islam rahimahullah went on to say many different things. Shaykh al-Albani has something similar to say. He said, many people ask me about, you know, the one who doesn't pray, the one who smokes. Do I boycott him? He said, I tell them, do not boycott him. Because if you do so, then he will be happy. He will be happy that because he doesn't want someone righteous reminding him all the time, now you have left him alone to follow his ways and his sins. He said, do not do so. The Shaykh went on to say that this muqata'a is a legislated means which is intended to bring about an objective, a maslaha. If it's going to make it worse and further mislead him, then it is no longer legislated. And the Shaykh said, today, we people bring statements, you know, the statements of the Salaf and the way of the Salaf. The Shaykh said, today the Muslims are weak. Al-yawm al-muslimuna du'afa. Today the Muslims are weak. In fact, we have to apply the narration. بَدَى الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَسَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَى. Islam began strange and will return to being strange. The Shaykh said, we have to look into things from a different way. What the Salaf were doing back then was applicable back then. Because everyone was upon the Sunnah. When someone came with an innovation and you boycotted him, it was effective. Now it's the other way around. The Shaykh, again, I would have to skip because of time restriction. قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ مَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ. The Shaykh said, if we open the door then of this hajr, muqata'a, you know, boycotting someone, tabdi'a, declaring people innovations, لَفَعَلْنَا مَا يُخَالِفِ الْمَصْلَحَ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ. Then we have done something which opposes the objective of Islam, the objective of the legislation of Islam. He said, rather, we prefer the siyasa, the politics of the statement of Allah, اُدْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ. Invite to the way of your Lord with wisdom, excellent, good preaching and admonishment, and argue with them, if ever, in a manner which is best. The Shaykh said, this is the way, this is our approach. Then he said again, the Muslims today, they started to divide over silly things and uncalled for things. And today we are living in an era where we need to have religious ease. He said, not in a sense with the kuffar, religious ease amongst ourselves. As in, we should not be, if we see someone among the non-Salafis, and we're not speaking about the group, meaning Salafi, someone who follows the way of the Salaf. If we see someone among the Salafis, let alone those who are not, with a varying opinion, different position, we should take it easy, we should love him, we should favor love, and what have you, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rather than boycotting them and staying away from them and warning against them and so forth. Every now and then we remind them concerning the evidences of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is based on the understanding and the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لا تقاطعوا. Do not boycott one another. ولا تدابروا. Do not turn away from one another. ولا تباغضوا. Do not hate one another. ولا تحاسدوا. Do not envy one another. وكونوا عباد الله إخوانا. And be brothers. Be a single brotherhood. Be brothers to one another. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is calling us to that. لا يحل لمسلم. It is not permissible for Muslim to boycott his brother for more than 3 days. They meet each other and they don't speak. And the best one or the better one is the one who begins the salam. So the Shaykh said, if you're boycotting him for a matter which is part of the deen, it's 3 days. If it's going to bring more harm, then it is no longer legislated, period. And he said, you know, the Shaykh went on to say many different things. Let me give you the summary or the juice of it. Akhwan, today, people have, blown matters out of proportion when it comes to the dealing with Muslims. We understand that they are the followers of the Sunnah and the opposers of the Sunnah. And concerning both, we need to have lenience, gentleness, kindness in order to bring him to the deen. Individuals who persist and continue in their way of innovation after being advised and warned by the qualified scholars, then these are individuals which may be necessary to speak concerning them in order to protect the Muslims from their deviance. However, many people on the scene today who call for the Sunnah but have mistakes. Like everyone who calls to the Sunnah and has mistakes. They have been warned against, wallahi, wrongfully. Wallahi, wrongfully. And according to these ulama, whether Shaykh bin Uthaymeen or Shaykh bin Baz, or Shaykh al-Albani, or Shaykh al-Sab ibn Taymiyyah, this is not legislated. It is not legislated to boycott the Muslims. To say, Hizbi, Sururi, Ikhwani, everyone is given a name and a title. Why? Because you're not with them. Wallahi haram. Wallahi haram. Wallahi, you will see the consequences of this on Yawm al-Qiyamah. They think this is a joke. Muslims say, be careful of him. They spoke to him 10 years ago. No one followed up with him on what he believes today. Khalas. No need. Haram, ya akhi. Haram alayk. You need to verify. You need to investigate. And this person is upon the sunnah. Then where are you from the statements of the scholars? But people of desires don't follow the statements of the scholars. They go shopping in the supermarket of the scholars. How? The scholar, when we have a supermarket, a whole aisle of merchandise? No, they will pick the statements which are in favor and agreement with theirs, and they will put them in the forefront for you. Anything else which they say, they will hide under the carpet. Say, but the Sheikh said somewhere else, well, it's a lie. No, the translator is lying. The translator is lying. Yeah, right there, the Arabic text. How many people you know can translate? 10, all of them said this is sound. No. The Sheikh changed his mind. Or the worst thing, he made an error. Why are you taking this Sheikh and abandoning that Sheikh? Anything to justify boycotting you. We say to them, fear Allah. And cut this business. Yeah, akhi, you're Muslim brother. He's at the end of the day, your brother. If you treat him with kindness, with gentleness, he will let go of his innovations slowly but surely. If he does not, alhamdulillah, you have done your job. But from the beginning, you cut him off. You don't give him a chance and you make him hate you and hate the sunnah because of you, then what are you going to do with Allah on Yawm al-Qiyamah? That you were the reason why people saw the sunnah and ran in the opposite direction. Not because the sunnah wasn't attractive, because you're not a good salesman. You're horrible in selling the sunnah to the people. So we ask Allah to rectify our condition and theirs. We love them at the end of the day. Still we say they are our brothers in Islam. They love the sunnah so much, they went to extreme. We don't hate them. But we're displeased with this way of dealing with people. Everyone is warned against. Everyone. You can listen to any caller to Islam, by the way, on the scene except two or three. That's it. Anyone else? Ma'gul? Or in Lebanese, ma'ule? Everyone is going astray, ya Sheikh. Except these two or three, Allah yasalhak. Ala kulli hal. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Any questions related to the topic? تفضلوا. Otherwise, no questions unrelated to the topic. Yes, أخي.
Wa alaikum salam. Yes, as we quote the hadith that a Muslim's fire should be so far from a non-Muslim's fire that it shouldn't be visible, right?
Correct.
So if your interaction interacting with non-Muslim, and that is strictly to business purposes.
That's fine.
That is fine.
But make the da'wah, giving him da'wah part of your goals and objectives. Yani even though it's strictly business, add to the business of the life to come. Da'wah. So you make the way, the reason why you treat them kindly, the reason why you're just with them and all that, is because you're actually trying to at least deliver the good message of Islam to them. Business is something, we're speaking about hanging out, going out, dinner, breakfast, beach, and all these things which lead to deviance. Of course, you may have to interact even here with non-Muslims at occasions. This is totally fine, as long as you don't take him as your intimate friend and you abandon the Muslims. Now, barakallahu fi, good question.
Because of the work conditions, maybe the qualifications or the visa restrictions, it's not always possible.
Well, the ayah mentions, the ayat in the same surah, if you read these ayat, they speak about those whom Allah Azza wa Jal exempted because of their inability. So anyone who's unable, as we know, it's part of the principle of Islam, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسع. Allah will never burden the soul beyond its scope. Anything which you attempt and you strive to do, but you fail, in the sight of Allah, you have done it with your niyyah. You have failed because of inability, because Allah didn't facilitate it. So those who are actually unable to migrate because of some other restrictions, but their niyyah is there, these are most likely to be protected amongst all those who are living there willingly, and they don't want to do hijrah because they're having such a dandy time. You see? Now the heart will bring about Allah's وَاللَّهُ خَيْرٌ حَافِظًا وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحْمِنَ. Allah is the best of protectors for who? Those who want protection from Allah. So those who try to leave, I know some, for example, brother who wanted to do hijrah, but his children have a physical disability, where any country in the world actually is not suitable for his children to survive. That country is actually, you know, modern in a sense, you know, technology-wise, that the whole country is actually compatible with these handicapped children. If they were to come to some of the Muslim countries, his children will suffer. But his heart, he wants to leave. This one is most likely to be protected by Allah Azza wa Jal. Because his niyyah was there, he was unable. But the issue is with the one who's living here in the Muslim land, but his heart is dying to go out. He can't wait to go out. This is the one who's in great danger. Because he's leaving the Muslim land, going against the narrations, and endangering his deen. If sitting with the ironsmith is going to, the Prophet ﷺ warned us that it would burn your clothes, then living with them would burn your deen. It would burn your iman out. With the fire of Jahannam, yani it's very dangerous. So, I mean, I always tell the Shabab, don't get overexcited. Don't think it's a picnic. Oh yeah, you'll go over there, you'll graduate, come back. Yes, it does happen, but not very often. I, myself, have sat with more than one individual, okay? Muslims, born Muslims, who went to these countries for a short time, came back, I debated with him in the Da'wah Center for 2 hours. Guess for what? 2 hours trying to prove to him that there's a creator for the heavens and the earth. Ey wallah, his name is Muhammad. For 2 hours, he would debate with me, say, well, he said, well, no, gravity mixed with molecules, with blah, blah, blah. I said, listen, man, cut that stuff out. Who created gravity and the molecules and all that? Fine, you say that came from something else. Fair enough. Who brought these into existence? You know what he said? He said, I don't know, but it doesn't have to be Allah. This is the epitome of kufr and ilhad. And a person who was a Muslim a few years ago in the masjid saying Allahu Akbar behind the imam. Why? He went over there, thought he was Mr. Cool Guy, mixed with a couple of guys, his iman was gone down the drain. Happens to many youth. Many, 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 many more than you imagine. But they keep their stories, you know, on the down low. Because it is not good to spread them. Otherwise the people will become afraid. And this doesn't serve the media. They want us to go there, get brainwashed, and come back over here feeling that you're living in the nastiest space in the world because it's a Muslim country. Women can't do this, men can't do that, we can't do this. Okay, so they make you feel like you're in a prison. And they don't want you to feel like that. They want you to live like them so you can end up in the same destination in the life to come. And we need to be very careful of that. Now,
Sheikh Al-Muslim, the ulama have set down certain exemptions traveling to the non-Muslim lands, such as travel for medical treatment.
Okay.
Travel for dawah, and I believe the third is for education that would later benefit the Muslims.
We have to omit the statement would later. I mean, if you mean it in that sense, yes. These exceptions are very restricted. For medical treatment, you're going to go there, have the surgery, and come back. You're not going to live there. If you go in there for da'wah, then barakallah feek. You're going to go give a few lectures and come back. You're not going to live there for 10 years giving da'wah. And if you did, and you're a da'i, mashallah, your knowledge is high, you're qualified, you got your iman, and you got your wife and everything, go ahead. How many of us qualified? Keep it real. And the last one is in very important condition. If you're going there to learn something, education, not for you, not for your salary to be higher, not for you to have a degree from that university, but strictly to benefit the Muslims, provided that that major, that field does not exist in a Muslim country. Yeah, and you want to major in something which doesn't exist, there's no such thing in the Muslim universities, and you're going there because you want to serve the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not your pocket. How many of us qualify for that? And even then, the scholars add to that, if you're going strictly for the Ummah, not for you, and you must have strong religious commitment, you must be strong in the deen and aqidah, and you must know that you're not the type who's weak in fitna. After all these are met, they say, go, get that degree and come back for the sake of Islam. But today, that's not why it's done. I speak to these shabab all the time. He knows in the depth of his heart. He's going because his father told him, look man, you graduate from here, you're going to be selling, chewing gum. So you go over there, inshallah, you come back as an engineer. It is not for the sake of Islam. It's for the family, for the pocket, for his reputation, for his, whatever. It is not for the sake, and if it is not for the sake of Islam, the ulama do not allow it.
Okay, sorry, Sheikh Musa, but a follow-up to that. What if they're a non-Muslim country, nationality, or passport holder? Like, let's say they're American or British, or French or German, and that's just their nationality, that's their country. Like, does their Islamic religion, religious adherence take precedence over their nationality?
According to Sheikh Albani, yes. According to Sheikh Albani, he said if the Muslims who are born in the non-Muslim land are expected to do hijrah, then what about those who are living in the Muslim land and wish to go over there? And this is in the actual note cards. So the Shaykh was of the position that if you are born there and you become a Muslim there, you're also expected to do hijrah. Now this is the position of Shaykh Albani rahimahullah. I do understand that there are a variety of opinions, but from my personal experience and what I believe to be strongest, not as a mufti or anything, I give the advice according to what I think is safest for the ummah. Other people may have different opinions, everybody seeks Allah's guidance in their affairs. But what about the hadith, acquire knowledge even if you haven't traveled to China for it? Wow! Hadithun mawdu'un ala nabiyyina sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a fabricated narration. There are two narrations concerning knowledge which are fabricated. One, utlubu al-ilm walau fi al-sin, seek knowledge even if in China. And the other one, utlubu al-ilm min al-mahdi ila al-lahd, seek knowledge from the cradle to the grave. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never said those. Never said those. So you're not going to go to China, so you can learn, you can learn the deen over here. This is a fabricated narration. You can't act upon it. The only authentic hadith concerning the obligation of seeking knowledge is طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. Seeking knowledge is obligatory upon every Muslim. That is the correct hadith, and it doesn't speak of China. Anything else? تفضل يا مدير. Make it short. Waalaikum salam.
These days, there's a trend on the internet, new innovation, which is people have on every Friday, they say, Jumma Mubarak. It's an innovation, But like you said, we have great philosophers as well. Okay, so they say that it's a blessed day, this happened, that happened. So you are just being extremist. So how do we explain them that?
It's very easy, akhi. Anytime someone comes with a bid'ah, anything which they try to rationalize and show it, justify why it is okay to do, you have one default answer, which is, أخي, you are in one of two conditions, or you are making one of two allegations. Either the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم knew that this is a good thing to do, to say Jum'ah Mubarak, but he didn't do it, so you say he failed to convey the message completely, or you know something which he didn't know. There's no third for them. Either he knew he didn't convey, you accuse them of treachery. Or you know better than him, you are better guided. So anything they say afterwards, say, أخي, did the Messenger of Allah say that? Don't you think he knew Jum'ah was Mubarak, was a blessed day? Did he not teach us that? So what made him stop from saying to the people, Jum'ah Mubarak? Because this was not part of his sunnah. So how do you insist on doing something which he insisted on leaving alone? You must be better than the Messenger of Allah. That's what you're saying. So this is a silencing refutation except for the followers of desires. They will still argue with you afterwards. And this is when you remove them from your friends list.
There are some people who justify that, like, you know, like some of the countries are very beautiful, and so like we can go over there and, like, you know, see the, like, different signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the non-Muslim countries. How do you perceive that one?
Tell them, look, the pictures or these images you want, I will email them to you. No problem. You want waterfalls, rivers, I will Photoshop. I will make the nicest things for you. You can sit at home and watch them all day and all night.
Now we have 360 panoramas for everything.
There you go. So, I mean, that's not an excuse. Tell them, somebody tells you.
For traveling or...
Shai, tell them, Akhi, someone tells you there's a delicious, delicious, wonderful looking cake with poison inside. Okay, you can keep telling me, but yes, but look how, look at night, yes, but there is poison. Now you go there and you see the ayat of Allah Azza wa Jal, and you will forget the ayat which you had memorized in your heart. I mean, common sense that people, people who want to follow their desires will continue to come up with excuses. Our job is to convey the message and give them a logical argument based on the Quran and Sunnah, and then we ask Allah to guide them and continue to give them da'wah. But this should be, you know, sufficient enough. You either email it to them or you remind them that yes, you may have a good time seeing the ayat of Allah, but you may lose your deen in the process. And it happens. Barakallahu feekum. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Shadu la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.